So by the time Emily was in fifth grade, she was in a wheelchair. My wife and I were missing work frequently to take her to specialists in Delaware, in New York, in Philadelphia, trying to alleviate her diagnosis, which was dystonia.
Acted just like every other kid, like nothing was wrong. And I also thought it was remarkable that the rest of the kids thought everything was just fine. That's the way Emily was. Nobody really gave it a thought that Emily walked a little bit differently than everyone else.
Seeing her just gradually get worse, it was hard. It was hard on us. We saw her, she had to crawl around the house. She almost lost her ability to walk. It was very hard to see Emily in school. She was on so much medication. She was so tired, and she would fall asleep in school. And that was just hard seeing that. But it made us realize that she's really ready for this surgery. Because we knew after the surgery she wouldn't need to be on any medication. So that was good.
We had to have a surgery. And the surgery was pretty serious. And what we heard about the surgery is that they had to... Is that okay to...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
What I remember about the surgery that... They had to drill a hole into her skull.
Yep.
And she had to be awake.
Yes.
During this time. In order to do the procedure accurately, they had to do that.
Before I left to have my surgery, we had a huge pizza party and everybody got to say their goodbyes to me. And everyone in the class made me a banner. And it said everybody's favorite things about me, and everyone made me cards and supported me. And then when I got back, because my head was shaved, they had a crazy hat day, so I wasn't the only person wearing a hat.
We went into the surgery having been in a wheelchair for many, many months, and she came out and she was able to ride a bike within 2 weeks from having the device turned on. It was 100% improvement. You could see it. It was effective. And I say to this day, and this was 2009 that the surgery was, that it's a miracle that we live in 2009, not in 1980 or 1950, when some of the surgical options were lesioning the brain, which is going in and actually burning off the part of the brain that sends the wrong signal. That's not a fun thing to do. So this has been extremely successful. You know, it was a difficult journey of many years to get to that. But now we still have to take days off from work and go up to New York. And we still have to see the doctors and get things tuned. She still has to go around metal detectors at the airport because she's got this pacemaker for the brain in her head. But you know, she's up, she's walking, she's dancing, she's riding her bike, and, you know, if you didn't know her history, you would never know that she had been in a wheelchair earlier in her life.
Just because I've had my surgery doesn't mean my experience with dystonia is over. Every few years, I have to get my batteries replaced, and if they run out before I get them replaced, my symptoms come back. And even if my batteries don't run out, my symptoms have the ability to get worse. And when that does happen, we have to drive all the way up to New York, where my doctors use the remote to raise my settings so that the signals being sent to my brain are stronger.
Even though I was in a wheelchair and I had a brain surgery, there are a lot of people with dystonia that are a lot more unfortunate than me. I'm very lucky to be functioning at the level that I am and that I can still go to school and walk around and do what I can do. And